come back. We were introduced by Bruce at the Stone Pony. All that concentrated juice, standing room only. You were with some suit from EMI or Sony, who was so full of toot, he called for Moni Moni. You came back to the slum, the squat with Lars and Sammy. Then Lanois' green thumb grew us a golden Grammy. And then our double album hit a double whammy. When it reached number one, we reached for our Swami to make a comeback. A comeback, don't you see? It's time to come back. Come back to me. Then our master's voice told us it was cool to park the Rolls Royce in the swimming pool, while our drugs of choice were run from Istanbul through a girl called Joyce, whose real name was Mule. We loved the paparazzi flash, the paparazzi zoom. When we finished our stash of magic mushrooms, we'd pay in cash for a kilo of cartoon and come back to trash another hotel room. Making a comeback, don't you see? It's time to come back. Come back to me. When we broke up, we swore we'd never kiss and tell, never speak to each other. Until hell freezes over, or whatever hell does, when it's co-produced by Eno and Woz. But behind the music and Where Are They Now have pointed the way. They've shown us how to take a leaf from Plant and Page and Fleetwood Mac and set the stage for a comeback. A comeback, don't you see? It's time to come back. Come back to me. We no sooner said farewell than it was time to reunite. A flame's likelier to swell in a diminished light. For though we're a hard sell, what with the cellulite, we're still clear as bell, we're still pretty tight. So let's remember the fans as we fan the embers and hit the meadowlands this coming September. When we take each other's hands, baby, let's remember we're just another band with only two surviving members making a comeback from yet another rave. A comeback from the grave. Cuba. My eldest sister arrived home that morning in her white muslin evening dress. Who the hell do you think you are, running out to dances and next to nothing? As though we hadn't enough bother with the world at war, if not at an end. My father was pounding the breakfast table. Those Yankees were touch and go as it was. If you'd heard Patton in Armagh, but this Kennedy's nearly an Irishman, so he's not much better than ourselves. And him, with only to send the word. If you've got anything on your mind, maybe you should make your peace with God. I could hear May from beyond the curtain. Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. I told a lie once. I was disobedient once. And father, a boy touched me once. Tell me, child, was this touch immodest? Did he touch your breast, for example? He brushed against me, father, very gently. So this next one's called Amshaw. When the master was calling the roll, when the master was calling the roll at the primary school in College Lands, you were meant to call back Amshaw and raise your hand as your name occurred. Amshaw, meaning here, here and now, all present and correct, was the first word of Irish I spoke. The last name on the ledger belonged to Joseph Mary Plunkett Ward and was followed, as often as not, by silence, knowing looks, a nod and a wink, the master's droll, and where's our little ward of court? I remember the first time he came back, the master had sent him out along the hedges to weigh up for himself and cut a stick with which he would be beaten. After a while, nothing was spoken. He would arrive as a matter of course with an ash plant, a sally rod, or finally the hazel wand he had whittled down to a whiplash. Its twist of red and yellow lacquers, sanded and polished, and altogether so delicately wrought that he had engraved his initials on it. I last met Joseph Mary Plunkett Ward in a pub just over the Irish border. He was living in the open in a secret camp on the other side of the mountain. He was fighting for Ireland, making things happen. And he told me, Joe Ward, of how he had risen through the ranks to quartermaster, commandant, how every morning at parade his volunteers would call back Amshaw and raise their hands as their names occurred. So thank you very much. I'll read a couple of poems for you. This most recent book, and 1,000 Things Worth Knowing. It's called, this is a little poem called Pelt. Now rain rattled the roof of my car, like holy water on a coffin lid. Holy water and mud. Landing with a thud. Though as I listened, the uproar faded to the stoniest of silences. They piled it on all day, till I gave way to a contentment I'd not felt in years. Not since that winter I'd worn the world against my skin. Worn it fur side in. So just occurs to me, what a delight to be back in this great gallery. A few years since I've been here. It's been closed for a while, I think, hasn't it? And great exhibition on downstairs, do you see it? Great stuff. This is a poem about a painting called, it's by, excuse me, I've got terrible allergies. It's by Camille Pissarro, and it's in somewhere in Texas. I think it's, anyway, it's in Dallas or somewhere like that. I think it's Dallas. And it's from a series of paintings he did depicting apple pickers, apple picking at Iragny-sur-Ypte is the title. So like many say, an ekphrastic poem, it's a riff on the painting. And Camille Pissarro, apple picking at Iragny-sur-Ypte. Christ may as well have been hanged for a sheep as a lamb. Given how the so-called panking pole, loosening a dam of apples lodged between bowls, is used by one of the work gang to pierce his side. His garment, strewn on the grass, is a shadow without a seam. Two of the women grope in the morass for anything they might deem salvageable after attacks by varmints of various stripes. A third stares at his rib cage, stifling her gasp in anticipation of another gush of blood and water. The centurion grasps his pole more tightly, as if the flash flood of apples might be about to gauge its own significance. That middle distant horse, asleep between the shafts, is at least absolved of the mounting block. Given the successive grafts of noble scions upon noble stocks, when I glance from my hotel window, even I discern a possibility I might too readily have spurned, that any of these rangy, raw-boned trees is the one I will turn into. And I think maybe just a couple more, if we may, we'll have a little this one's called Honey. So I'll read this, a little song lyric, and then I'll end with another one. How's about that? Should bring us up to time. Where's the blues man? I see, he seems to have packed up shop. Honey, our plain takes hill upon hill, long since cleared of pines. The flash of matching lakelets, weather and more weather. The co-pilot points to at least one benefit of failing pines for warship keels, namely how the heather that pits itself against an old saw pit and fills in the great gash of a logging road also sustains our friends, the honeybees. The coroner at the scene of the crash found the seams of Buddy Holly's jacket of yellow faux leather split almost full length, and his skull also split. Buddy's personal effects amounted to a pair of cufflinks, together with the top of a ballpoint pen, and barely within his remit, the $193 in cash, from which the coroner deducted $11.65 in fees. Well, those were the days. So Buddy Holly features in this next poem, which is called It Won't Ring True. I said poem, it's a song lyric. Once your spray tan and my fake ID would take us anywhere we needed to be in this world or the next. Now I've set aside my feelings for the pain you've been revealing in your most recent text. My pride is hard to swallow, and my promise overdue. But if a promise isn't hollow, you know it won't ring true. Your idea that I might take a plane through sleet and freezing rain is so vacuous. Don't forget the whopper Buddy told the big bopper about getting off the bus. Buddy had played the Apollo to victorious reviews. But if a victory isn't hollow, you know it won't ring true. You said I was talking hot air. I was talking through my hat. I was striking the wrong chord. I was either sharp or flat. Someday, I'll hit the right note on a Martin D42. If a guitar isn't hollow, you know it won't ring true. That is not strictly true, of course. But I want you to give me the benefit of the doubt there. Once my fake ID and your spray tan were all we had in our retirement plan, then you headed for the hills. There's a chance you reconsider and go with the lowest bidder and bend to my will. I never said I'd follow, is my excuse to you. But if an excuse isn't hollow, you know it won't ring true. But before I do so, I would like to say what a pleasure it has been to spend the afternoon here. What a fabulously organized competition. Thank you very much to one and all involved. I mean, one tries to dissuade people from the idea of competition. But if you're going to have one, have it like this. And congratulations to all those who were read earlier on. Thank you very much for your good work. Thank you very much to Ben, otherwise known as, I'm hard of hearing. Thank you very much indeed for that. It made me think how happy the Beowulf poet or Homer would have been to have a loop. So I'm going to do a little looping myself here and come back I started, I think, or close to, with a poem called Cuba. This is called Cuba 2. And it's a poem about a trip I took to Cuba with my daughter a couple of years ago. She was 21, I think, 21 thereabouts at the time. And a couple of things you should know. We have a history of ovarian cancer in our family, a history of it. And what else? Ah, I think that'll do us. So anyway, thank you very much indeed for the, and I'll end with this. Cuba too, it's a kind of rollicking little poem. Cuba too. I'm hanging with my daughter in downtown Havana. She's worried people think she's my mail order bride. It might be the anchov tattooed on her ankle. It might be the tie-in with that poem of mine. The 59 Buicks, the 59 Chevys, the 59 Studebakers with their white-walled wheels. The rain-bleached streets have been put through a mangle. The sugar mills, too, are feeling the squeeze. We touch on how Ireland will be inundated long before the nil-nil draw. Che Guevara's father was one of the Galway lynchers. Now a genetically engineered catfish can crawl on its belly like an old school gorilla. Maybe a diminished seventh isn't the note a half-decent revolution should end on. The poor with their hands out for pencils and soap. Hopped up though I am on caffeine, I've suffered all my life from post-traumatic fatigue. Even a world-class sleeper like Rip Van Winkle was out of it for only 20 years. A fillet of the fenny cobra may yet fold into a blood pressure drug. A passion for marijuana may yet be nipped in the bud. Some are here for a nose job, some a torn meniscus. The profits from health tourism have been salted away. The blue scorpion takes the sting from one cancer. Ovarian may yet leave us unfazed. Hemingway's sun hat is woven from raffia. He's tried everything to stop the rot. He's cut everything back to the bare essentials. His 55 Chryslers in the shop. We'll sit with Hemingway through yet another evening of trying to stay off the rum. I'm running down the list of my uncles. It was Uncle Pat who was marked by a gun. Our friends Mayor Lansky and the Jewish Mafia built the Riviera as a gambling club. Had it not been for the time differential, Uncle Arnie might have taken a cut. The best baseball bats are turned from hibiscus. They're good against people who get in your way. The best poems, meanwhile, give the answers to questions only they have raised. We touch on Bulat and Yevgeny, two Russian friends who've since left town. The Cuban ground iguana is actually quite thin on the ground. The cigars we lit up on President's Avenue have won gold medals in the cigar games. Now it seems a cigar may twinkle all the more as the light fails. My daughters led me through Hemingway's villa to a desk round which dusk drinkers crowd. She insists the anchov on her Achilles tendon represents her being in the here and now. The cattle egret is especially elated that a plough may still be yoked to an ox. Others sigh for the era of three martini lunches and the Martini Henry single shot. When will we give Rothstein and Lansky and their heavies the collective heave? In Ireland, we need to start now to untangle the rhetoric of 2016. The Riviera's poo is shaped like a coffin. So much has been submerged here since the Bay of Pigs. Maybe that's why the buildings are wrinkled. Maybe that's why the cars have fins. Thank you.